speak up, you may receive some, what we would call persecution, okay? Or some comments, or some pushback, or something like that. Everything that we have operates on is the average power source, and you can get by with that. You can live life pretty good. But with the baptism of the Holy Spirit, one moves up to 220 volts of operation. There are instances where you could not operate on 110 volts. You must have that 220 volts in order to get the results that you're looking for. And that's sort of like the Holy Spirit. In this message, we'll be looking at three basic areas of concern: the Holy Spirit at salvation, the work of the Holy Spirit, and the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Now, the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. At the time of salvation, at the time that you ask Christ to come into your life, you receive the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. He comes and takes up residence in your life, and he begins the process of restoration, recreation, various terms that are used to describe that, but he begins to change your life. It is referred to as being indwelt by the Spirit. He takes up residence in your life. At this time, the Holy Spirit begins to regenerate your life. Regeneration is when the Holy Spirit begins to take control of your life and begins to replace the old nature with the new nature. And note, I'll keep emphasizing, it's a process. He begins the work of transforming who you were into that person that you will be in Christ Jesus. It takes time to get rid of the old habits, the old ways, the way we used to think, and so on. And over a period of time, he replaces that the old with new concepts. His concepts. His way of thinking. His way of doing things. Titus 3:5 tells us, he saved us, not because of righteous things we had done, but because of his mercy. He saved us through the washing of rebirth, a salvation, and renewal by the Holy Spirit. Again, referring back, you're being renewed. You begin to understand this when what you used to think was funny is no longer funny. You get a different feeling in you. That's the Holy Spirit working within you. He is changing you. That's good. That's what we want. Romans 8:9 tells us, you, however, are not in the realm of the flesh, but in the realm of the Spirit. If indeed the Spirit of God lives in you, and if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, they do not belong to Christ. This is scriptural evidence that in salvation we receive the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. But the indwelling of the Holy Spirit is not the same as what we refer to as the indwelling of the Holy Spirit, or the Spirit baptism. That's a different setting, a different situation, which I'll quickly explain. And as I said, I'm going to be giving out a lot today. If you don't grasp it, that's okay. Ask me, I'll try to explain it to you, because what's involved in this message this morning really takes several messages to explain what the Holy Spirit is all about. The ministry of the Holy Spirit, or the work of the Holy Spirit, the things that He does in your life. The Holy Spirit is constantly at work in the believer's life, and now catch this, as well as unbelievers' life. He is constantly influencing. He is constantly influencing those of us who have accepted Him, but He is also constantly influencing those who have not received salvation as of yet. They're candidates, if you will. Right, so the process is always going. You're never alone. You're never left on your own to come up with your own thoughts. The Spirit is constantly there. The Spirit of God never stops working in our lives. And He ministers in many different aspects. The ministry consists of, and I'm going to go down through these rapidly. He convicts the world of sin, John 16:8. He regenerates the believer's life, John 3:5. He indwells the believer, 1 Corinthians 6:19. He sanctifies the believer. 2 Thessalonians 2:13. He provides power for believers, Acts 1:8. He teaches, John 14:26. He reveals, 2 Peter 1:21. He guides, John 16:13. He intercedes, Acts 8:26. He witnesses with our spirit. Hallelujah. He lets me know I am a child of God, even though Monday mornings I don't feel like it. I get up Monday morning and I say, oh, good Lord, this morning. But that doesn't mean I'm not any less than a child of God. You see, we can't trust our feelings. That's another subject on its own. Don't trust your feelings. They fluctuate up and down for who knows reason why. He directs us, Acts 16:6-7. He strengthens us, Ephesians 3:16. He reminds us, John 14:26. He establishes the Christian in the body of Christ, 1 Corinthians 12:13. He produces spiritual fruit in the believer's life, Galatians 5:22-23. He gives spiritual gifts to believers, 1 Corinthians 12:7-11. And that's not an exhaustive list. But it begins to give us ideas of what the Holy Spirit does for us, in us, through us, with us. And so it's vital that we understand what the Spirit, God's Spirit, sent by Jesus to live in us, to indwell within us, to make us into the image that He wants us to be. Okay? Now, I'll make a bold statement. You can live your entire Christian life in the indwelling of the Holy Spirit and never be baptized in the Holy Spirit. Okay, does it make you any less a Christian? Christian doesn't make you any more of a Christian. The baptism in the Holy Spirit. It is in the indwelling of the Holy Spirit that he begins to produce fruit in your life. He produces fruit in your life. You don't produce it. You don't become more loving. You don't produce more joy. That's the Holy Spirit in you. And you notice that in circumstances and situations aren't the great, but you still feel the joy of the Holy Spirit. The peace and so on as you go down through the fruit of the Spirit. This is He's producing in you. Going back to Acts chapter 1, verses 4 and 5. On one occasion while He was eating with them, He gave them this command. Do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift My Father promised, which you have heard Me speak about. For John baptized with water, but in a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit. When you are baptized in water, alright, you are immersed. That's what we believe. Alright? Immersed. Totally put on. Okay? And if you pay the pastor enough, he'll let you up on your sides. Now the idea is that you're being completely submerged. And that's the idea or concept of the baptism in the Holy Spirit, is that you are experiencing a submersion, a total reception in the Holy Spirit. With a reason. There's a purpose. As Christ's time on earth drew to a close, He gave a command to His disciples. This command was, once again, do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift My Father promised you. At the time of salvation, you could imply in here, wait. Do not go out. But wait until you are baptized with the Holy Spirit. Again, there's a reason and a purpose in Scripture for this command. Telling them, as well as us today, to wait before you go out to do ministry, witness, perform miracles, whatever the case may be, in His name. In this promise, you can find at least two. The promise reveals that they have a need. We have a need. That need is we are not able to accomplish what He has given to us to do. We can make bold statements, but 99.9% of us are not capable of, and I wouldn't even go to the extra point percentage, none of us is really capable of doing the ministry that He has given us to do in our own power, in our own strength, in our own wisdom, no more than they were capable of doing. They were successful, the disciples, because they were filled, baptized with the Holy Spirit. And they were enabled to do and accomplish what God gave them to do in the various situations that they found themselves. And remember, at that time, they were in hostile. And sometimes we find ourselves in hostile territory. But fear not, for God is with us. They and we need divine power, wisdom, and direction to act upon His command to go. Go into all the world and preach the message. Whatever level that might be. wherever that might be, whatever the reception might be, we are to speak. Speak with boldness. Speak with accuracy. And speak without fear and trepidation. The natural self is fearful. Jesus was telling them and us, do not go in your own power, wisdom, or strength. The task before us is too great, too much for us to accomplish in our own. Now this is important. The baptism in the Holy Spirit is for divine power to go. Is not to make you pure. Okay? Yes, there are overflowing blessings, but this is the primary purpose, is for power, divine power, the Spirit of God giving you that 220 volts, if you will, to do that which He has asked us to do, and do it successfully. We need a 24/7 connection and fellowship with the Spirit. The second promise in this passage is that Jesus would give us a 24/7 comforter and companion. Why do you think you need a 24/7 comforter companion? Why do we need the Holy Spirit 24/7? Well, the answer I come up with is because ministry is messy and difficult. Why? Don't be offensive, but people are messy and difficult. You can run into all types of situations, all types of settings, all types of challenges that people have within their life. Some are not as challenging as others. Others are very, extremely challenging. And it's only through the power of the Holy Spirit that He gives us wisdom how to respond to this situation. How to begin to give the advice. How to begin to lead that person or persons in the direction of Jesus Christ. And even the other end, the power to be able to receive rejection. You may have all the truth possible, but that doesn't mean people will receive it. They're rejected. They reject you. They may call you names. They may, in some cases, there's physical attacks. There's whatever the case might be. Is that going to stop you? Not in the power of the Holy Spirit. I begin to read through the Acts account. The things that they did, that was not in their power. That was not in their ability. The things that happened. And those are just some of the instances that took place. It's still happening today. The Holy Spirit is still doing the miracles. He is still doing the wonders that we see in the book of Acts. And He's doing it in the places where people are subjective to Him, or subject to Him. People who are willing to receive from Him with the purpose of putting it out. Not holding it within. If one is fully involved in doing ministry for the Lord, they will sooner or later want to quit and throw the towel in. It's just not worth it in the natural. Most people that I know in ministry at one point or another, and maybe more than once, get the feeling, I need to find something else to do. There's other things that are easier, less challenging than what God, what you call me to do. But that's where the Holy Spirit comes in. If you're truly called of God, He will infuse you once again with divine power and divine ability, and you're more than willing to step out and continue to do, even though you may not understand, you may not see the results that you think should be accomplishing. Okay? Why aren't we at 5,000 people here? Well, that's the thought when you begin to read ministry and all the big things, and all, we started with 15 people in 5 years, we're at 5,000. It happens, but it doesn't happen all the time. There are other purposes, there are other reasons, there are other how the Holy Spirit uses people in situations and so on. It's not the number, it's what's being produced that makes the world of difference. The Holy Spirit is there beside you 24/7, enabling you to, encouraging you to, and empowering you to accomplish His goal for your life. The purpose of the baptism, Acts 1:8. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be. Catch that. You will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, that's the beginning point, and in all Judea and Samaria, that now you're expanding out outside of Jerusalem into the surrounding area. But he doesn't stop there. And to the ends of the earth. That's where we are today. We are at the ends of the earth. He's called each one of us to speak the message of Jesus Christ where we are and what we are doing, relating it to the people that we are around. Whether you're in a foreign country doing missionary type of work, that's part of God's plan. Okay, not all of us can go to the mission field, but yet, yes, we can. Because where you are, the people that you come in contact with, that's your mission field. That's the people that God has called you to influence. Regardless of the setting, some settings, as I said, is more difficult than others.